Good afternoon. My presentation reflects the introductory chapter of the draft of the collection policy document that is currently under review. And I think it seems to give a good overview of the policy of the whole collection, not only the Judaica and Israel collections, which is actually the main theme of our of this session. And in the following presentations by my colleagues, we'll give a more detailed review of the Judaica and the Israel collections. And once this entire document is approved by the board of directors, it will be published on the library's website. One of the essential principles involved in the process of the renewal of the National Library is creating a focused definition of the fields of collection. Previously, they had been more loosely defined, and this was mostly connected to the fact that the library served directly as the humanity library of the Hebrew University. And in this role, the library was supposed to fulfill the research needs of all the humanities. The physical separation from the Faculty of Humanities The physical separation from the Faculty of Humanities that was moved to Mount Scopus 30 years ago, together with some of the library's collections, was an impetus for change. The financial difficulties that accompanied the practical split of the library created a situation in which the library collection range remained quite wide, but not actually comprehensive. Simultaneously, the traditionally strong points of the collection that for practical and historic reasons were in the fields of Jewish studies and what has been termed then Oriental studies, consisting mostly of Arabic and Islamic studies, remained in force. Various investigatory committees recommended in principle during the 90s and early 2000 years that these strong elements as the core subject of will be the elements of the core subjects of the library, whilst dividing the material that was included in the Jewish studies collection into two distinct areas, Judaica and Israel. Thus, the three core subjects The three core subjects that the library intended to focus its collection activity on were defined in the law of the National Library and its master plan. The principal goals of the library were defined in the National Library Act in 2007, as you can see here on the both the main goals and the tasks of the library, to which I will come back soon. According to the new definition of the core collections of the library, fields whose content relate to the core subjects or supports them are defined in the library law and master plan as the humanities collection. Fields that are not at all related to the core subjects or that are only very slightly related are no longer part of the library's development policy. I will deal briefly with exceptions at the end of my talk. The core subjects, as you can see now on this slide, are Judaism, Islam, Judaism, Israel, and I was confused by ISL, and Islam and the Middle East. The humanities collection, subject of the second circle, if you wish, that is related topics and general historical background issues such as Christianity and the history and culture of the Mediterranean basin, these are included in the general humanities collection. As far as formats are concerned, these include, of course, book manuscripts, original microfilms or scans, printed books, archive materials, musical items, electronic databases, and digital archives, digital collaborations at the library's initiative, or in response to other institutions' initiatives. Most of these, mainly the physical items, are of course not new to the library. These had been part of the main core of the library for the last 120 years, which we now celebrate. Now, we distinguish between three groups of formats: current publications in print, musical, or digital items. Two, costly digital items, databases and digital archives. And number three, special and rare items. In addition, attention will be also paid to the library's financial capability as a consideration in policy discussions. This reminds me of the famous saying, which is quoted in Ecclesiastic Rabbah, on the authority of Rabbi Yudan, in the name of Rabbi Ibo, "En adam yotze min haolam v'chatzi tavato v'yado." Nobody departs from the world with half his desires gratified. So this is not new, this is old, and this is always relevant. And I assume that this is a problem of any library, big or small, including those aspiring to have the most comprehensive collections. So it's just a question of percentage points. Capability includes, aside from purchase price paid to suppliers, other tasks such as conservation, library procedures, maintenance, and services. Special attention is given to the library's areas of strength, which are now shown on this slide: our Institute of Microfilm Manuscripts, the Gershom Scholem Kabbalah Collection, National Sound Archives, our collection of ancient maps, and collection of Israeli and Jewish press. Now, we need, of course, further definitions of what we plan, what we aspire, what we desire to collect. Some publications are easily identified as belonging to the core subjects. Almost every publication of Hebrew letter or language, for instance, music or movies, will be defined as belonging to the field of Judaism or of Israel. However, there are publications that do not, by definition, belong to these fields or whose connection needs careful consideration, and this need may arise from various reasons. I'll just mention a few examples. The library does not acquire significant publications in the field of science and technology, since these areas fall, of course, by definition, outside of the core subjects. On the other hand, non-Hebrew belles-lettres, novels, poetry, plays, by Jewish authors whose content is only faintly connected to Judaism or Israel. And in this category, the curators or selectors do not need to delve deeply into the content or its interpretation. Rather, it is preferable to take a broader interpretation and purchase the book. Similarly, this also applies to audiovisual publications in this category. Many publications that mostly contain popular sermons on the Old Testament or the Bible are worthy of a careful, very careful selection process at the time of purchase. And lastly, in cases where the amount of articles on Judaism or Israel published in journals, also in these cases, mostly just isolated issues of such periodicals will be purchased. Also, the library has no intention of creating an extensive Islamic and Middle Eastern studies collection, but rather intends to create the best research library in the country, an excellent library as an international on an international level in this field. That is, a library that will attract researchers in Israel and from abroad in the future in the same way in which it has done for many years in the past. The most complex issue regarding definitions is that of the general humanities. The master plan does not include a clear guideline, and therefore a much clearer definition is hereby proposed. This field can be perceived as assisting and supporting the core subjects. A sharper definition would include following principles. In general, background material on the history of the Jews in all the lands of their dispersion throughout the ages belongs here. Another area is social sciences, publications that support support publications that specialize in the core subjects. Acquisitions in these fields will be mainly at the basis of at the basic information level. Secondly, history and culture of the Mediterranean basin in its broadest sense. This is the region of the growth of and development of the cultures which are the roots of the culture of the countries and societies included in the core subjects, namely the three monotheistic religions and the Western culture that we are part of. Literature, sciences, philosophy, and art of the ancient Near East, Greece, and Rome. This means undertaking a balanced but quite extensive collection of sources and research on the ancient Near East, classical thought and culture, and the history of the non-Muslim sections of the Mediterranean basin, mainly Byzantium, Italy, Spain. The curator and selectors of the general humanities will consider expanding the collection on Western civilization beyond the geographical definition and subjects that I have already mentioned, in particular to that of the history and philosophy of this culture in the Middle Ages and in modern times. Another main issue is the scope and the core subject collection. of the core subject collection. Of course, Judaica and Israel are considered national subjects. And for this reason, and in line with the library's renewed master plan, the scope of the collectors of the collection in these areas is expected to be comprehensive. In practice, it would be appropriate to limit and define the scope more precisely, partly because not every item is of such quality that is fitting with the for the collection, and partly due to the fact that the library's financial resources are limited. Of course, there is the publications that we receive as legal deposit, which you receive according to Israeli law, according to which it is obligatory to deposit two copies of every publication published in Israel in the library. Whether they are publications of the printed word, books, journals, ephemera, or whether they are produced in audiovisual format. Since the collection of such publications that fall in the field of core subjects or related areas should be across the board, the task of enhancing the enforcement of this law lies with the curator of the Israel collection. So the main task of selection lies, of course, in the field of what I would call foreign publications. Publications on these subjects that are published require different treatment in relation to the various core subjects. The library makes every effort to cover all such publications on Judaism and Israel as comprehensively as possible. In the Islamic and Middle Eastern Studies collection, the library will manage a selective collection with selectivity on discretion, distinguishing between essential publications and those that are only specific studies, and on the evaluation of selectors in their choice of books, journals, electronics, of course, preferred or printed, and databases. Publications of all formats that are published in Arab countries will be given special attention. Most of the general humanities collection consists of publications of this kind, and so considered and carefully selected is required. The library strives for cooperation and coordination with the Hebrew University libraries for acquisitions in the fields of Islamic and Middle Eastern studies and the general humanities. Issues of costly digital items, mainly databases and digital archives, and also special and rare items, mainly manuscripts, archives, physical archives, not digital ones. For some shortage of time, I won't go into details about these. It is a very complex issue. It involves many questions. I would say even it is sometimes problematic. I would say only as far as what happens in reality now, the library is much more in the market, both with respect to acquisition of digital, sometimes very expensive items, and also rare and special items like manuscripts and other kinds of documents in manuscript or very early prints. I don't like to say that library is a player in this field, but we are much more active in this field than we had been a few years ago. And this also reflects the independent status of the library and in its independence in making both decisions on selection and on financial matters. Now, as far as selection and purchase levels is concerned, we felt that we need sharper definitions on these matters. And the collection policy intends to establish these levels of selection and acquisition according to the method developed by a group of research libraries known as the RLG Research Libraries Group Conspectus, which I guess most of our American or North American colleagues are well acquainted with, and is currently used by the United States Congress Library and by many other collections of research libraries in the United States and also in Europe. The purpose of this method is to set a unified standard for assessing depth and breadth of collections in all research libraries. I should mention, however, at this point, that the conspectus has been devised for research libraries in the quite exact meaning of this term, while the National Library is not exactly a research library, because the definition of the National Library is much wider than a research library. And for this reason, the hierarchy of priorities in the various collections is not even in the library. I gave you here just the, in the slide you see only the titles of these levels. I will not go into detail, but this gives you, and I will say only very generally that we have, in a sense, adopted this method, but adjusted it to our needs, as I said before. And therefore, the National Library's collections on Judaism and Israel aim to reach levels 4 and 5 for a wide range of subjects and formats. The Islamic and Middle Eastern studies and the humanities collection require acute definition by subtopics or formats, so the picture is much more complex. There are exceptions. When the library's process of renewal began, it had some collections whose content did not relate to the core subjects at all. The library was required to decide whether to continue keeping them. The main consideration that need to be taken into account in these cases are the specific value and unique qualities of the collection, sometimes including an international reputation, and the existence of another institution of research or culture that would be interested in or has to maintain the collection in question. Again, it is a very complex issue, and I will mention just one example of such a collection that we decided to retain, and this is a Edelstein collection, a collection of history and philosophy of science, medicine, and technology, because it is in Israel a very unique collection, and even in international terms, it is a quite unique collection. There is no other institution in Israel that is prepared to take it, and therefore we felt that As a national library, it is our duty to retain this collection, and I'm sure that we will have more such cases in the future. Finally, acquisition of digital versus hard copy formats. The recommendations of planning team collection policy that preceded the master plan had the following definition. Library policy is to acquire items in their original format. That is, if the item was originally created digitally, then the library would prefer to purchase it in digital format. If the format is in hard copy, then it will be purchased as such. If it is possible to acquire both hard copy or digital formats, preference at this stage, and we are talking about the humanities library, is for hard copy format due to problematic aspects involved in digital preservation. As policy regarding digital preservation is being implemented, this is somewhat updating of the definition, including the acquisition of such a preservation system, the library will have a clear preference for digital format. For other collections, the overwhelming preference is to purchase items in digital format. So, since this proposal is conditional on decisions depending on future acquisition of advanced technology, and we are constantly in the process of such acquisitions, and on other future developments such as the need to prefer, in many cases, integration of archives, etc., decisions made regarding these questions in the near future will be as they are today, that is, in any case, under relevant circumstances, without establishing a sweeping principle. Thank you.
My name is Chezi Amiur, and I'm going to speak Hebrew. טוב, בעברית, שמי זה חזי עמיאור, ואני עוצר ישראל בספרייה הלאומית. אז מה זה עוצר ישראל? מה אני בעצם עושה פה? התואר נשמע תואר קצר, הוא גם מזמין הרבה מאוד חידודי לשון ובדיחות, אבל בעצם זה לא תואר קצר, כי כל פעם שאני אומר, מציג את עצמי, אני צריך להוסיף לפחות שני משפטים להסביר מה זה עוצר ישראל. אז זה תואר די ארוך למעשה. בעצם אני יכול לומר בצחוק כמובן שאני בעל מלאכה די שעומד לעצמי, יהיה לי קשה להקים איגוד מקצועי משלי, בוועידות בינלאומיות של עוצרים אני אהיה כנראה רק אורח, כי עוצר ישראל זה דבר שקיים רק בישראל, למיטב ידיעתי אין ממש עוצר ישראל אחר במקום אחר, ולמרות שרבים מכם, אלה שיושבים כאן, בעצם הם מנהלים באוספים שלכם הרבה מאוד ישראליאנה, הרבה מאוד פריטים של אוסף ישראל. בעצם אני רוצה להקדיש את הדברים שלי כדי להסביר את הייחוד של אוסף ישראל לעומת אוסף יודאיקה או בכלל. אז למה בכלל צריך את אוסף ישראל? אז אוסף ישראל כמובן הוא האוסף הלאומי של מדינת ישראל, הוא מתעד את התרבות הישראלית. בהרבה מדינות בעולם החדש יש לנו דוגמאות למדינות כמו ישראל של מדינה שקמה פתאום או לא פתאום אבל היא לא קמה בצורה לאורך מאות שנים כמו רוב המדינות בעולם אלא הגיע לטריטוריה מסוימת עם שמגיע לטריטוריה מסוימת ויוצר שם מדינה משלו הוא נפגש בטריטוריה הזאת עם תרבויות אחרות במדינת ישראל מתוך עיקרון, מתוך אידיאל, מבוססת על גלי הגירה, עלייה של, לארץ של קבוצות שמגיעות מכל מיני אזורים בעולם ומביאות איתן את התרבות שלהן לארץ וככה נוצרת כידוע בישראל תרבות מאוד מאוד ססגונית, מאוד רבגונית וגם מאוד מאוד תוססת ומשנה כל הזמן את פניה. ובכל זאת ישראל, למרות שיש עוד מדינות שונות לתיאור הזה, בכל זאת מדינת ישראל זה מדינה מיוחדת למדי כמו שכולם יודעים. אני רוצה להזכיר שלושה מאפיינים ייחודיים של ישראל שמשפיעים על כמובן על מדיניות האיסוף. ראשית, כבר התחלתי, כבר הזכרתי מקודם שמדינת ישראל היא המדינה של היהודים מכל העולם, מגיעים לפה יהודים מתרבויות שונות ולא רק יהודים, ואני ארחיב על זה בהמשך, אבל בישראל, בניגוד לארצות אחרות שהן ארצות הגירה, קשה להצביע על תרבות ישראלית שהיא התרבות המארחת, אלא התרבות הישראלית כל הזמן קולטת אליה תרבויות שונות שמצטרפות אליה והן בנות בית במלכתחילה, בעיקר מאחר שהן תרבויות יהודיות. היבט שני זה הקשר שבין המדינה או בין הציבור, בין החברה הישראלית לבין הטריטוריה שעליה היא נמצאת. אז קודם כל ארץ ישראל היא ארץ כידוע עתיקה מאוד, זאת ארץ שבה נוצרו התרבויות עתיקות מאוד, בעיקר היהדות והנצרות לענייננו. וארץ ישראל תמיד משכה אליה תשומת לב רבה מאוד, גם בלי קשר למדינת ישראל ולזמנים שבהם חיו יהודים בארץ ישראל. לכך צריך כמובן להוסיף את הקשר הייחודי שיש בין עם ישראל לבין ארץ ישראל, שמדינת ישראל בעצם מממשת אותו, וזה עוד נותן מימד נוסף של ייחוד לקשר שבין התרבות לבין הטריטוריה. ומימד שלישי שאני רוצה להוסיף, מאפיין שלישי, זה מדינת ישראל מוקפת, קיימת באזור שהתרבות השלטת בו היא תרבות ערבית. מלבד זה שרבים מהמגזרים ומהקבוצות שמתקיימות בתוך החברה הישראלית הן מקורן בארצות ערב, ויש להם, היה להם כבר בארצות מוצאן מגע חזק מאוד עם תרבות ערבית ועם האסלאם. בתוך מדינת ישראל קיים מיעוט מאוד מאוד גדול של ערבים, שאולי לאורחים מחוץ לארץ זה קצת נראה, זה קצת אולי יישמע מוגזם מה שאני אומר, אבל ללא ספק המיעוט הערבי בישראל מעורב מאוד בחברה הישראלית ובתרבות הישראלית. בזה בוודאי, זה בוודאי הבדל גדול שיש בין התרבות הישראלית לבין יהודאיקה בכלל. הבאתי רק דוגמה של ספר ילדים ערבי מהסוג של הדברים שאנחנו אוספים כאן. טוב, כל מה שאמרתי, אני אמנם עוצר ישראל, אבל לא באתי פה להרביץ בכם ציונות, אלא כמו שאמרתי, זה נועד להסביר את מדיניות האיסוף שנובעת מהמאפיינים האלה. אני רוצה להציג כמה משמעויות, להדגים כמה משמעויות של מדיניות האיסוף שנובעות מהדברים שאמרתי עד כה, ובעצם גם לחדד דברים שחגי אמר פה לפניי על מדיניות האיסוף הכללית של הספרייה. מעבר לדרגות האיסוף שחגי הזכיר, הייתי פורס את האיסוף, את האוספת אוספים שבתוך הספרייה, בתוך אוסף ישראל, קצת בחלוקה שונה. יש תת אוספים שבהם אנחנו רוצים להגיע לאוסף מלא, כלומר אוסף מלא במובן המלא שלו, כמו למשל אוסף הספרים או אוסף העיתונות. יש אוספים שבהם אנחנו רוצים להגיע לאוסף מייצג, מאחר שאי אפשר לאסוף אוסף מלא, אני קצת ארחיב בהמשך. ויש אוספים שבהם אנחנו רוצים ממש להיות מתמחים ולפנות בעיקר אל המחקר. מה שאמרתי פה, במיוחד לגבי האוספים המלאים, זוהי אחריות מאוד גדולה, מחויבות מאוד גדולה, שהיא גם מחויבות שאנחנו מחויבים לה בחוק, אבל היא מחייבת בעיקר, האחריות הזאת מחייבת אותנו לקבוע מדיניות ריאלית, מדיניות שאפשר להשיג אותה ומדיניות שאפשר גם למדוד את ההצלחה שלה. בשבוע שעבר הספרייה הלאומית פרסמה לרגל שבוע הספר את הדין וחשבון השנתי של ההוצאה לאור בישראל. ופורסם מספר הספרים שנדפסו בישראל, כמובן זה העיקר, מספר הספרים שפורסמו בישראל בשנת 2011, והיה על זה דיון, כמובן דיון ציבורי, ואני רוצה לשאול, להציב כאן כשאלה, מה זה בכלל ספר ישראלי? כשאנחנו מדברים על ספרים שיצאו לאור בישראל, על מה אנחנו מדברים? מה שאנחנו רואים כאן על המסך זה דין וחשבון של ועדת בדיקה של המשרד לאיכות הסביבה שפורסם בשנת 2008. הדין וחשבון הזה הוא דין וחשבון פנימי שהוגש למשרד לאיכות הסביבה לצורך הסקת מסקנות. הפריט הזה קיים, הפריט הזה הוא פריט ארכיוני, הוא לא ספר, חשוב להדגיש את זה. אנחנו שותפים של גנזך המדינה, של ארכיון המדינה, שאוסף את הפריטים האלה, כל החומר הארכיוני שהמדינה מייצרת, שזרועות המדינה מייצרות, אבל אנחנו, גם אם יש מי שיחשוב שהספר, שהפרסום הזה דומה לספר, הוא אינו פרסום במובן הפשוט של המילה, הוא פשוט לא פורסם, מדובר פה בפריט שלא פורסם. לכן הבאתי את זה כדי לחדד שכשאני אומר שאנחנו רוצים אוסף מלא של אוסף הספרים הישראלי, אנחנו רוצים את אוסף הספרים האמיתיים הישראלי, כלומר אוסף הספרים שפורסמו בישראל בצורה של פרסום כפי שמקובל. נושא שני שאני רוצה לגוע בו זה, הזכרתי מקודם את העיתונות, גם אוסף העיתונות של הספרייה הלאומית אמור להיות אוסף העיתונות הישראלית, אמור להיות אוסף מלא. אבל שוב אני רוצה לשאול שאלת טעם, מה זה בכלל עיתון? רובנו כשאנחנו שומעים את המילה עיתון אנחנו חושבים על העיתון היומי בישראל, מעריב, ידיעות, הארץ, יש שבועונים שאנחנו מכירים אותם שמתפרסמים אחת לשבוע, יש ירחונים, כתבי עת, ברור לכולם שפה מדובר בעיתונים. אבל מה בדבר דברים שמתפרסמים באופן סדרתי כמו עיתונים, אבל הם לא בדיוק עיתון במובן המקובל, הם משהו אפמרלי יותר מעיתון. כאן אנחנו רואים את אלוני בית הכנסת, אלוני פרשת השבוע שמתפרסמים בישראל, אתם רואים שיש כאן לא מעט, והנה עוד אחד. מה שאתם רואים כאן אלה רק פרסומים מהחברה החרדית, רק כאלה שהתפרסמו בשבת האחרונה, בפרשת השבוע האחרונה, ורק אלה שמתחילים באלף ובבית. זה כדי להמחיש את מה שאולי רבים פה מתעסקים בו ביום יום, את ההיקף האדיר של של אלוני פרשת שבוע בישראל. אלוני פרשת שבוע יש גם בחול. אבל בישראל מדובר במאות רבות מאוד של אלוני פרשת שבוע, וכפי שאמרתי, כל אחד יודע גם שאלוני פרשת שבוע יש להם אורך חיים קצר מאוד, כך שאם זה מה שקיים במצב, בזמן נתון, אז מדובר בכמויות רבות מאוד. ברור שלא ניתן לאסוף באופן שיטתי את הכל, במיוחד כשמדובר בעיתונות שהספרייה הלאומית גם מכוח החוק טובעת אותה כל שבוע מחדש, אנחנו רוצים שיהיה לנו אוסף מלא, כלומר אנחנו רוצים שלא יהיה חסר לנו אף פריט. בלתי ניתן לאסוף את הכל, ואנחנו חושבים שמעבר לכך שבלתי ניתן, אפשר גם לפצות על כך שאנחנו לא יכולים לאסוף את הכל, ואנחנו אנחנו אוספים את אלוני בית הכנסת על פי פרמטרים של ייצוג גיאוגרפי, חברתי, של ז'אנר מסוים, של קבוצה מסוימת. חלקם אנחנו אוספים באוסף מלא, חלקם שהם יותר כמו עיתונים, ואנחנו בסך הכל מנסים בצורה כזאת להגיע לשילוב שיתן לנו תמונה מהימנה של שחומרי אפמרה מהסוג הזה צריכים לתת לנו על החברה הישראלית ולתרבות הישראלית. הנושא השלישי שאני רוצה לדבר עליו זה האופי החי והשוטף של אוסף ישראל, של איסוף בתחום ישראל. בניגוד לאוסף יהדות קלאסי, לאוסף יהדות רגיל מהסוג שאתם מנהלים, אוסף ישראל הוא לא אוסף רטרוספקטיבי. אנחנו לא מנסים לאסוף אחורה בזמן את הפריטים שהם החשובים, אלא אוסף ישראל הוא אוסף שחי כל הזמן, והוא אמור, מאחר שהוא אמור לתת תמונה מלאה או מהימנה, אנחנו מנהלים אותו כל הזמן. החומר החשוב של מחר, ואת זה אתם יודעים, הוא החומר שאוספים היום. ואנחנו באוסף ישראל צריכים להגיע למצב שאנחנו אוספים היום את מה שיהיה חשוב מחר, כי מחר אי אפשר יהיה להשיג את מה שאפשר להשיג היום. כאן אתם מזהים את זה? זה הדבר שנמצא אצלכם בתוך התיק, זה פריט אפמרה שפורסם הבוקר. מחר אף אחד כבר לא ישתמש בו. אנחנו אוספים פריט כזה כמובן, פה מדובר במפה, ויש פריטי אפמרה מסוגים שונים, שהאיסוף שלהם באמת מאתגר כדי להגיע כמובן לאוסף מייצג, לא לאוסף מלא, אבל שייצג את האזורים השונים בישראל, את כמו שאמרתי, את התרבויות השונות וכולי. או אם אני רוצה לסכם את הדברים, אנחנו לא אוספים, אנחנו לא נרתעים מלאסוף את הדברים הפשוטים, או אולי אפילו המשעממים, מאחר שאין לדעת איך הם יראו בעתיד, או אני יכול לומר בוודאות שכל אחד מאיתנו שיסתכל היום על פריטי אפמרה שפורסמו רק לפני 5 שנים או 10 שנים, ימצא בהם הרבה דברים שהוא לא ימצא בהם היום כשהוא יראה אותם מפוזרים ברחוב או תלויים על לוח המודעות. אז באוסף ישראל, לעומת אוסף יהדות, הייתי משתמש, הייתי ממחיש את זה בכך שאנחנו משתמשים, אם הים, אם החומר נמצא בתוך הים, אנחנו לא דגים בחכה, אנחנו דגים ברשת. כמה הוספות, הערות נוספות למדיניות שמתחייבות מהדברים שתיארתי. קודם כל, חשובה לנו מאוד הגמישות, הגמישות בהתאמה לשינויים התרבותיים שקורים בישראל, לשינויים החברתיים שקורים בישראל, כדי להמשיך ולהיות מייצגים גם כשיש שינויים, והם קורים כל הזמן, כשיש גלי עלייה, כשיש שינויים תרבותיים מסוגים שונים בכל מיני תחומים, והמדיניות שלנו היא צריכה להיות גמישה ככל האפשר וניתנת לשינוי. דבר שחשוב כמובן לומר כאן, התפקיד שלנו בתור מוסד לאומי, והזכרתי למשל לשיתוף הפעולה עם ארכיון המדינה, יושבים כאן נציגים של מוסדות אחרים בישראל, וגם כל שאר האנשים שיושבים כאן, אנחנו רואים את עצמנו כמוסד, כמו שאורן הציג את זה, כמוסד מארגן, שנעזר בשיתופי פעולה עם כל מוסד אחר שיכול לסייע לנו בדברים שאנחנו חושבים שהם חשובים. בעיקר, בגלל מה שהצגתי, אי אפשר להשתלט על הכל, ויש תחומי התמחות לכל מוסד. ונושא שלישי שחשוב לי להדגיש לגבי אוסף ישראל, בהמשך לדברים שנאמרו כאן, אוסף ישראל יותר מאוסף היהדות פונה לציבור הרחב בישראל, הוא מיועד לציבור הרחב בישראל. הוא מיועד גם לחוקרים, הוא מיועד גם לקהלים אחרים, אבל הוא פונה לציבור הרחב בישראל, וחשוב שהאוסף יהיה מאורגן בצורה שהדגמתי אותה כאן, חשוב לנו שנדע מהו ספר, וחשוב לנו שנדע מהו עיתון, וכן הלאה, כדי שהמשתמש הלא מיומן, בניגוד לחוקר, יוכל למצוא את דרכו בתוך האוסף הזה, ובכך למלא את הייעוד של האוסף. אני יכול לומר שאיסוף תרבות בהכללה הוא מוטה תרבות. אפשר לומר שאוסף איסוף בתחום היהדות, היהודאיקה, הוא מוטה תרבות. הממד הגיאוגרפי בו למשל הוא חלש. הממד של, יש ממדים שונים שלא קיימים ביהדות, באיסוף קלאסי של יהדות, כמו למשל ענייני צבא, ענייני כלכלה לאומית, ענייני ביטחון לאומי. לעומתו, איסוף ישראל הוא עוסק המון בתרבות, אבל הוא מוטה טריטוריה, מאחר שהוא אוסף של מדינה שנמצאת במקום מסוים, והיא כוללת בתוכה גם תרבויות שונות, כמו שהצגתי כאן, היא גם, האוסף קשור חזק מאוד גם לארץ ישראל כטריטוריה שהיא לא קשורה דווקא ליהדות. ארץ ישראל באלפי השנים האחרונות, רוב הזמן לא הייתה במצב שזה היום, ויש לנו, ואנחנו אוספים כאן חומר נוצרי רב על ארץ ישראל וחומר מהעת החדשה המוקדמת וכן הלאה. הודות לאוסף היהדות של הספרייה, אוסף ישראל נולד בעצם לפני כשנתיים מתוך אוסף היהדות, ולמעשה הספרייה הלאומית אספה אוסף ישראל באופן שוטף לאורך כל השנים. מהסיבה הזאת אוסף ישראל מרגע שהוא נולד הוא כבר נעמד על שתי רגליים יציבות. אבל לא רק זה, גם בניהול השוטף של האוסף אנחנו נהנים מאוד מהשיתוף פעולה הפנימי שלנו בספרייה, בין אם זה עם אוסף יהדות, כפי שהזכרתי, שהוא בעצם המקור של אוסף ישראל, והוא כמובן נותן את הגיבוי של הקשר לתרבות היהודית, בין מדינת ישראל לבין התרבות היהודית, אוסף המזרח התיכון והאסלאם, שמספק לנו קשר חיוני עם הסביבה שבה מדינת ישראל נמצאת, גם אוסף מדעי הרוח הכלליים, שנותן לנו, כפי שהזכרתי, את הרקע התיאורטי ואת הידע הכללי על התרבויות, בין אם התרבויות הקדומות שנולדו בארץ ישראל או שהיו קיימות בארץ ישראל, ובין אם תרבות המערב שבמידה רבה מקורה בארץ ישראל, או שהיא משפיעה מאוד על התרבות הישראלית כמובן. אני יכול לומר לסיכום שכל הדברים שאמרתי יכולים להישמע להרבה אוזניים כיעדים אולי קצת שמרניים ויעדים אולי קצת מחושבים, אבל הם יומרניים מאוד. אני כמובן לא פירטתי את הכל, אבל זה יעדים יומרניים מאוד שאני מקווה שאם אנחנו נעמוד בהם, אז באמת נוכל למלא את הייעוד שלנו להיות האוסף שמבטא את התרבות הישראלית ומין שומר חותם של החברה הישראלית היום, מחר וגם למען הדורות הבאים. תודה רבה.
My predecessor spoke in Hebrew. I'm supposed to speak in Yiddish or in Judeo-Arabic, but it's very weak. So well, I'm going to say firstly, before I speak about the policy, I want to say a few words about the collection, a general description of our collection. What I always find interesting about our collection, obviously there are libraries that have more manuscripts and libraries that have perhaps, or archives that have better archives. What's unique about this collection is the collection of formats, and there are very few institutions which have all of these formats together. And these formats are very important because they tell us the story of our people in many, many ways, in many layers, in many dimensions. So these are the five major collections, but there are, of course, a few others, and I'll expand later on. Printed books, periodicals, manuscripts, archival material, and music. This is what really makes the Judaica collection so unique of the National Library. And some theory, because we're writing policy, so it has to be theoretical. We have to improve some people who are reading the collection policy. Yosef Chazanovich, he was, I believe, from Odessa. Bialystok. He is the founder. We see him as the founder of the National Library. And if you can try to, later on, we're going to have a break. And when you leave the room, you'll see opposite you there is this engraving on the wall between the two library halls, the general reading room and the Judaica reading room. And what it says here in English is his vision, Chazanovich's vision: a great house, high and lofty, will be built in Jerusalem, our holy city, and all the produce of Israel's spirit will be stored there, etc. By the way, what you see here is on the right is Hatzfira, and I was able to search for this very quickly. I just put in a few keywords in the website JPress, and it came up. And that's an amazing tool for those of you who are not acquainted. You should try it once. So I want to focus on three things that Chazanovich said. And one of the things, he's talking about the protos of Israel's spirit. And I think at the end of the 19th century, it's perhaps obvious for somebody Jewish in Eastern Europe to think about what is a national institution, what is a national Jewish library in these terms. And of course, for various reasons, historical reasons, things to do with the Jewish people and in the past 120 years, our outlook is a bit different than the way it is described here. The other thing that he said was stored here. By definition, Chazanovich saw the collection, something that is stored within the building. If it's not here, it's not part of the collection. But for many, I mean, this conference and other conferences, everybody, and in fact, we've been speaking since David Ben-Gurion, that was mentioned this morning in 1950, at least since that, we see the National Library has considered Hebrew manuscripts in microform part of its collection. So it doesn't, and of course Chazanovich, for technological reasons and other reasons, saw it differently. And lastly, when he talks about the audience, the people, his clients, who are the clients, who are the people, who are the users of this library, he's talking about our rabbis, the sages, and the intellectuals of our people. And he was thinking of professors. And the truth is, all of these things, to some extent, have existed in this library. I believe, certainly after the Hebrew University, at least the humanities and the social sciences, have moved to Mount Scopus, the main users were in fact professors. I don't think these two were here. That has all changed, and if you look at the mandate of this of the National Library Law, it talks about, of course, collecting, preserving. It talks about Chezi's collection, emphasis on the land of Israel, the state of Israel, and the Jewish people in particular. And I think this is something very different than when you're talking about this intellectual capsule of Judaism. It's much more extensive in a way. So if we bring this all together, the two strategic themes that I see are, the first one is increasing the collection of popular material. And I would say, when I talk about popular material, it might not be the right word, but it's not all about Maimonides, for instance. I love Maimonides, but it's not all about that. There are many other things that are very, very interesting. And it's not like the library wasn't collecting this for many, many years, but I think this is something that we now realize, or at least we can put it into words. If you think about newspapers are not necessarily great intellectual achievements. We read the Israeli newspapers every morning. Believe me, they are not great intellectual endeavors, but we collect them and every day. And of course, strengthening the digital collaborations, because that is what is going to give you a much, much more interesting collection. And David Bloomberg gave the example this morning of the manuscripts, where the National Library holds probably less than 10%, correct me if I'm wrong, less than 10% of the Hebrew manuscripts that we know of in the world, but it has become a center where people who are interested in Hebrew manuscripts, they come here because of the facilities of a catalog of all extant Hebrew manuscripts and other services. So some boundaries about our collection, and I don't think Chezi spoke too much about the boundaries and Chagai. It's a very, there are, in fact, one of the professors who is reviewing currently our collection claims that, for instance, I'll just give you an example, Zionism should be part of my collection and not Chezi's collection, because he sees Zionism, I wonder what Moti's take is on that, whether Zionism is part of Judaism or is it a part of Israel? I mean, these are questions that, frankly, in reality, I don't know if they really matter. I don't know what practical implications they have, whether the Zionism books are going to be on this shelf or on that shelf. We get along together. And there are three, if we're trying to explain what Judaism is all about, so I think we're talking about documenting three arenas, or at least the national, talking about the people, discussing the people, focusing on the people, and then the cultural, the linguistics, the Jewish languages, the various Jewish languages, and then the religious, because obviously most of the material that you'll find, at least until the 19th century, is religious or semi-religious. And the structure of the collection, we're talking about these arenas, and then we talk about collection areas that I'll go into in a minute, and then collection formats, which are, of course, very interesting. And again, this is very theoretical. It doesn't have many practical implications, except for our bibliographers, our selectors, are going through, when they look at a book, they try to see whether is it something about a literary area, is it something about biographical or organizational or thematic area. Everything has to fit in here in some way. But what are the formats? Because the library itself operates on formats. These are the main formats, and I would like to say something very short about each one of them. The first one is the printed book, of course, and that's the classic. When the library was established, they collected books. And I think you'll stop 9 out of 10 people in the street, and they'll ask them, what is a library? And they'll tell you, books, bound books on shelves. And we are bibliophiles. We believe in books. We spent a lot of great resources trying to get books. Again, like David said this morning, some books we know nobody will ever read. There might be a scholar who he or she might not actually be interested in reading the book, but they would go over, they would want to know where this book was published and certain characteristics for bibliographical analysis. So this, of course, will continue. So it includes not only every Hebrew book, it includes every book on Judaica in any language. Judaica meaning as we go back in the previous slides, and when we talk about different themes. The other thing is, and we're going to have a session dedicated to the Hebrew bibliography. Part of our digital strategy is digitizing Hebrew books, being as comprehensive as we can within the limitations of, let's say, copyrights, but also creating, reviving the Hebrew bibliography project, which operated here in the building, and it sometimes had, I believe, 20 people working on. So there are, of course, other ways today to do this, but this is something which is very central. It's true that we always say that the Judaica collection, in fact, I'll tell you, if you look at the law, the Israeli law about the National Library, it doesn't say that we have to collect books. Maybe in 20 years, the curator will say, well, we don't have to collect books anymore. It's obsolete. Maybe we should focus now on just anything that is born digital. It's possible. But right now, at this moment, we try to get every single book, whether in digital form, and sometimes try to get the real thing. Periodicals, magazines, newspapers. What we will attempt to do in the next few years is to increase the acceptance of more communal periodicals. Some of them, although we try to get, it's very difficult. Today, almost every community has, and even today with digital age, a lot of printed magazines of different, even in the United States, almost every community has several magazines, and unfortunately, we don't have all of them. In the former Soviet Union, we're aware of the situation, and we are trying to improve this because we feel this is extremely important. Again, remember, what is the Judaica collection? It's not only about intellectual compositions and creations. And in addition, I've just demonstrated how important this J-Press is, and we're increasing, we're adding more and more newspapers to this website. Manuscripts, we will have a session about manuscripts and what we plan to do with this. But we are, again, investing resources in trying to get digital images of manuscripts, and also we acquire manuscripts, especially because we feel that they're so important. Many times, if we will not acquire that manuscript, it will remain hidden in some vault forever. And many times it's worth to put the resources and get one manuscript, giving up a few books, because that manuscript is unique and it contains information that is very valuable. Archival material. So there are several things that we have to work on. It's Owen spoke this morning about improving the documentation, which it's very problematic. We have great archives, but some of them have not been documented, meaning they're not online. You cannot find them with our finding aids. This will improve immensely in the next few years. We also have, I believe the next session is about creating an international archive, international and national archive index, which is extremely important because scholars come, they don't really know where the material is. We want them to be able to, that the same way you work with Google, you type in Echad Ha'am, and it will tell you that the National Library has some of the collection, and other collections and other institutions have. And of course, the most important element, I'm sure Hadassah is going to relate to this today, is the cooperation between the National Library and the Central Archives for the History of the Jewish People. That is something essential, because this expands, as you know, the archives that are in the National Library are mostly personal archives, and this is something that will expand this. These are communal archives and contain much more information that Hadassah will speak about today. Ephemera, my favorite. I think the ephemera collection here is great, but it's mostly Israeli. I would say it's mostly Israeli. And this is something that we would like to expand, receiving more and more information from other from other places in the world, and this is something that you can help us with through contacts, getting us in touch with people who actually will send us ephemeral material. Some people are very happy to send it; they just don't know that we're interested in that material. And I would very much welcome if you could assist us with this. Photographs. Again, this is something that we're constantly expanding, slowly. For whatever reason, Jewish pictures are all very sad, so I thought that might... this is also something that was mentioned before, digital-born material. There is so much information being published, and it is so important. I don't have to begin to tell you, and it's very pricey. I mean, people think that you can harvest the internet just like this. It doesn't work this way. It takes a lot of resources. But I strongly believe that we will have to move some of our resources and spend them on digital-born material because, like Oren mentioned this morning, there are 15 years that have been lost.
There was one thing that I found glaringly absent, particularly in Chesky's and Aviad's, presentations was lack of women. I need to bring that up, that in all the photos you showed of heroes of Zionism and all that.
Don't you read the newspaper? Yeah.
No women. No women had nothing to do with the creation of the State of Israel. So I just figured I wanted to make that remark, that's something that should be in the consciousness of people in your building of collections here in Israel.
No, but you're right. If you look, you know, Nanette, if you look at the in France. But if you look at the collection for, let's say, archival, I think out of 800 archives, there are probably 4 women. It's true, this is the... Oh, or 8. But this is true. This is something that has to be fixed.
Yes. I'm Hadassah Asulin of the Central Archives for the History of the Jewish People. Regarding the collection of ephemera, for many years, the Judaica Library of Harvard has been collecting Israeli ephemera, newspapers, theater announcements, government reports, bus tickets, what have you. Is there any cooperation, duplication, or whatever between you? Because they haven't been mentioned, and I noticed that they aren't present either.
Yes. So there are... we are going to cooperate with them, but... they and other institutions, we collaborate. We want to enrich our collections. To enrich our collections, and we try hard to do it. This year, we started a three years project of ephemera digitizing, and this will about half of the items. 150,000 items. About half of them are going to come from the National Library and other from other collections. With the Judaica collection of Harvard, we are talking with, but it's not still a stable cooperation.
I'd add on Harvard relations, we have 3 projects now under discussion. Harvesting the Israeli web domain. We're talking about cooperation there.
Israel, no? Uh-huh. Radio?
Well, they are working on digitizing now the Israeli broadcasting and the collection. We're supposed to have this part of the collection available. The IBA will put most of it on there. We can take some of it, combine with other subjects that we digitize as well.
I have the mic. This is a question. This is Naomi Steinberger from the Jewish Theological Seminary. Question to Chezi. Is your mission to collect only in print? And also, what about Israel-related materials published outside of Israel?
No, we don't collect only physical material. But I focused my presentation about physical material, but it's not this. About abroad ephemera or items about Israel, Aviad will do it as Aviad said. It's not a matter of who does it, but it will be happen.
No, if I may add on this point, of course we do collect items that are published outside Israel. I mean, this goes without saying. Whatever is published in Israel, we get under the law of deposits. So this is not no problem. The task of the Israel curator is mainly after, let's say, trying to enhance enforcement of the legal deposit to collect publications in whatever format that are published outside Israel. Of course we do.
I'm a little confused on the way the Israel collection is going to be handled. I understand it doesn't really matter whether you call it Israel or Judaic in certain areas. It doesn't matter who's responsible to make sure you get everything. So you do have to have that definition clear. So if you're saying that you're not buying anything retrospectively, if I understand, does that mean that somebody else will be making sure to do that? And I'm looking at the division. The example you gave of current Judaica was Alonim from Bate Knesset. I mean, of Israeli stuff. To me, that falls under Judaica. So I'm just kind of wondering how you're going to handle some of those issues. Well, who will be responsible for making sure that all of rabbinic materials, tapes, for example, of rabbis or things along that line, will become part of the collection and so that it won't slip between the cracks, something like that. Same thing for music. And same thing for preservation, decisions on preservation.
Israeli items are collected in Israel collection. Jewish stuff from abroad. It doesn't matter if it's about Israel or if it's about Judaism. And this why it's not. It could be printed items and it could be tapes or like that. We work together and it's the system is more flexible. If the Judaica collection have his network abroad in other states, so he will collect also the items of the Yordim or like other items of which related to Israel. It's a Jewish stuff, and we don't. It's just more.
So you'll be responsible for collecting Israeli rabbinics, for example.
Mm-hmm. Also, yes. There's some women over here. We were speaking about women before.
I wish to add something also on this, because there may be a question who is responsible for Israeli rabbinics, but one area is definitely the responsibility of the Israel curator, and this is the Arab society in Israel, which is a very important aspect of the work of the Israeli collection. So because of problems of language, the Israel curator has to collaborate on this particular point with the curator of Islam and Middle East. But as far as responsibility is concerned, this is no doubt this responsibility. Arab society, Arab Israeli culture, everything like which belongs to this area is a responsibility of Israeli culture. And this is one very peculiar subject in the responsibility of the, or in the parameters of the Israeliana collection in our library.
I have two questions.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I have the microphone.
Two questions. One is regarding the definitions of Judaica. Everyone here deals with this, and we have been dealing for centuries with this question. I'd like to know if you did some research on how the definition of Judaica changed over time in here in Israel. And the other question that I think should be included in the first one is, I found it a little bit disturbing, the concentrical organization of your Judaica with religious in the core, linguistics involving it, and the national. I would suggest you to revise that. Rethink that. I think at least an overlap in which some parts get separated, and then we can get a diverse definition of Judaica.
The thing is, I mean, it's very theoretical, but in reality, like I said, the nature of most of what we're collecting is religious material. I mean, within the Judaica collection. I mean, that's the reality. That's the way things were. Most of the books that have been published, most of the manuscripts, up until a certain time, let's say, up until the emancipation, are religious. And now, of course, they have their. They're not only religious. I mean, we look at the perspective of, you know, what language they were written in, what their influences. But if you look at most of the material that is published in the, I'm talking about even modern books that were printed in 2012. So usually, a large proportion will be. I'm talking about what we acquire, and we try to acquire extensively anything that is published. So if it's history, what is it history of? So it's either history of religious elements or of the people, what I call national people / people. I don't remember what the term was in Hebrew. So this is really reflects the reality of what we're dealing with. I mean, it's just like, you know, I would like to say to Nanette, the reality is, how many books or how many manuscripts were written by women? No, in other words, very, very few, right? No, I'm again, if we look up until the 19th century, or even...
Written by women on Yiddish and literature.
How many books? How many books were written in Yiddish?
Not only how many books.
I mean, this is the reality. We might not be happy about it. Yes, but what it means, I'll tell you what it means. It means we're talking about, it's a collection that deals with people, with a nation, with people. And without that nation, there is culture. Every nation has a culture. And without that culture, within that culture, religious was very dominant. That's all what I'm saying. Of course, today, religious is a very, very small part of the culture, contemporary Judaism. And you know, the pictures of people
in which there is religion is not the subject of the book.
I didn't understand that.
If you have a book that is dealing with a political issue, maybe religious is not the subject, and the subject would be nation and linguistic, or even not dealing with linguistics.
So we collect that. We collect that. Oh, I understand. Okay, now I understand. So you had a problem with my diagram, not with the policy.
My problem with the idea that is behind your diagram.
We have time for one last question.
Okay.
Well, I have the power. I have the, okay. And you'll be pleased, this is a really, really simple question. I'm very interested in we are also developing the, or what we call refreshing our collection development policy, which is supposed to suggest to our stakeholders in our community that we're not really changing very much. But of course, there are some significant changes with, you know, digital developments and so on underneath there. And we're having a debate about, do we consult while we're developing the policy and frighten everybody, or do we consult kind of after we've developed the policy and then get accused of not consulting? What have you done in that debate?
May I ask?
Yes.
As I said, the policy document is now under review. We sent it to no less than 45 reviewers inside Israel, of many areas, occupations, and if you divide it to the four collections, let's say on average, every such chapter in the document was sent to something like 8, 9, 10 people. Not all of them responded, but we really chose to consult at the stage of preparing the document rather than producing a somewhat which we consider final and then get all the criticism. No, we did exactly the other way around.
I just want to make a couple quick remarks. First of all, coming back to the Harvard question, Harvard's had a Documenting Israel project.
You mean the Harvard problem?
No, I don't mean it as a problem. I think it's been stated so far as a problem. I mean it as a curiosity that they started in the 1960s creating a project called Documenting Israel. And I just wonder that in formulating the Israel policy and in terms of overlap, or for example, did Harvard collect the first 10 years of the Israeli web and things like that? The second thing I want to just pose to you guys, which...
on this particular question, the answer is no.
Okay.
They did not.
You don't
they
know?
Did,
or?
They did not. We know. We know that they did not.
Yeah. But did you consult their overall policy in formulating your own?
We took it into consideration. I cannot say that we consulted.
Yeah, because it was supposed to be a comprehensive policy
okay.
for documenting
it. Okay.
But the second thing is I want to point about the way that you guys pose the difference between Israel and Judaism or Judaica. It'll be very interesting to hear how Professor Rossman, you know, takes this apart later. But it also strikes me as a different way of thinking about it, which is the difference between humanities and social sciences. And that, I mean, how can Parshat HaShavua not be Judaism? But if it's the sociology of religion in contemporary Israel, then it's Israel. But if it's about Parshat HaShavua, then it's got to be Aviat. But it makes a difference for maybe us outside because somebody has to pay for it. And so the decisions that we make are not ideological. It's a way of rationalizing, you know, out of my budget, should I be handing this off to the social sciences bibliographer to pay for it, or should he be handing it back to me to pay for it? So I just wonder if the distinction between the what's called the synchronic dimension of social sciences is useful for distinguishing from the humanities approach of and more chronological diachronic of Judaica.
I would like to say that because the question of money usually reflects on my budget. We're trying to develop something that is very flexible in terms of acquisition. I don't really care who decides what, as long as the decision is good. And nothing falls in gaps. So we have allocation of budgets is coming up very flexible. We take the money, we divide it at the beginning of the year. We have a monthly meeting, checking the acquisition budget, and if there is gaps in between, we transfer the money. It's their decision, first Gretchen Wing decision.
We all sit in the same room and
yes.
we get to
This is another thing that it's a small library.
It's the National Library, but it's a small nation. So we're a small nation library. And they're sitting in one room.
They, oh, and it is relatives.
Yes. And we try to encourage discussions between them, between the selectors, between those researchers that are sitting here, between you and them. And if we find that we made mistakes, we should find it fast and make the correct decision to ratify them. Okay, so.
But you can be sure that the Jews are the most expensive.
The discussion is fascinating, but I baked the cakes myself, so.